Okay, I think that we're going to go ahead and get started. In the interest of time, welcome to instructional course 114, Brain Vascular Anatomy and Intracranial Pathologies. We have four speakers, 22 minutes per speaker, and 3 minutes at the end of the session for questions. I do want to acknowledge the fact that this is part of our Global Partner Society program, and as such, we have Dr. Watanabe here giving an interesting lecture at the end of this session. So can we go on with the slide? Let me begin by stating that I have no pertinent disclosures to the lecture, and let's move on to the first case. You can see that this is a patient that presents with fairly nonspecific clinical history. On the diffusion-weighted imaging, you see some small infarcts deep in the white matter. You see a lot of white matter disease on the T2-weighted images, extensive symmetric, and no gadolinium enhancement on the post-GAT T1-weighted image. And it should not come as a surprise that when this case came across our reading room, we offered a very extensive differential diagnosis because we really had no idea what it was. So the patient went to biopsy, and it came back as a granulomatous angiitis. So making the diagnosis of vasculitis is extremely difficult. It's very rare. The imaging findings are fairly nonspecific. The clinical findings tend to be nonspecific, and what we see in luminal vascular studies is actually a vasculopathy and not a vasculitis. To see a vasculitis, you must visualize active inflammation, and you must do vessel wall imaging. We're going to mention it, and Dr. Watanabe is going to talk at the end of the lecture also on vascular vessel wall imaging. So I am going to go ahead and review some very common or common etiologies of vasculitis, particularly viral and autoimmune, which are the ones that we see more commonly at our institution. Mention a little bit on differential diagnosis, particularly the reversible vasoconstriction syndrome, as this can simulate a vasculitis even by vessel wall imaging. Review the clinical and imaging manifestations, point at some findings that may help us reach a diagnosis, and talk about the utility of MR, particularly vessel wall imaging. So let's go ahead and get started with the definition of vasculitis. Definition of vasculitis includes inflammation and necrosis of the blood vessel wall. Remember that it is a process that affects both arteries and veins. Secondary vasculitis that is occurring in the context of an underlying disease is much more common than primary vasculitis, which is idiopathic. And there are very common disorders, such as atherosclerosis, which seem to mimic vasculitis. But remember that in these processes, there is no active inflammation. And this is very important because when there's active inflammation in true vasculitis, then the patient will probably have to undergo an invasive procedure such as a brain biopsy and will undergo treatment with very immunomodulating or chemotherapy type of drugs. So it's very, very important that we make the correct diagnosis of vasculitis. So here's the second case. And I think that based on the clinical information that I give you and the description of the MR images that I'm going to give you, you should be able to suggest the diagnosis. You have a lot of leptomeningeal enhancement on the post-GAT T1. You have multiple irregularities of the middle cerebral artery on the MRA. On the ADC image on the right hand of the slide, you see the core of the infarct, very dark, extending from basal ganglia to the cortex. And then on the susceptibility weighted images, what you see is dilated veins at the level of the core of the infarct and extending posteriorly to the core of the infarct. And these vessels represent the area at risk in the brain or the penumbra. So what is the diagnosis or the most likely diagnosis here, guys? Anybody? Everybody's very shy. Where are my fellows that are here, my ex-fellows and current fellows? What's the diagnosis, guys? Okay, varicella zoster vasculitis. This is due to a reactivation of the virus in the nerve fibers that travel along the middle cerebral artery particularly, and there will be arterial involvement in about two-thirds of patients. For some reason, the imaging manifestations are different depending on the immune status of the patient. If you're immunocompetent, it tends to go to the middle cerebral arteries, and for some reason that I don't know, it tends to go to one middle cerebral artery rather than both. About 90% of cases affect the brain in a unilateral fashion, and only 10% of the cases are going to be bilateral. But if you're immunodeficient, the arteries involved tend to be those arteries distal in the brain, tertiary and fourth degree arteries. There is a 30% chance of stroke 1 year after the infection, and obviously treatment with antiviral antibiotics reduces the chance of stroke. As I said before, MRI shows you unilateral or less likely bilateral basal ganglia infarcts. If you do any kind of luminal study, such as an MRA or DSA, you're going to see narrowing of the arteries, particularly in the distal ICA and the proximal middle cerebral artery. But if you do vessel wall imaging, this will allow you to identify the inflammatory process at the level of the vessel wall, and you will see wall thickening, enhancement, and luminal narrowing. And all of these things that we're discussing on this slide will improve after you give antiviral antibiotics. So here's an example showing you bilateral abnormalities in the basal ganglia and on the flare images and the diffusion-weighted images. And notice on the MRA, there are bilateral irregularities of the middle cerebral arteries, particularly on the right side, as seen right there with the yellow arrow. But again, this is an unusual case because the involvement is bilateral. Here's another unusual case. On the flare image on the left hand of the slide, you see bilateral basal ganglia abnormalities, but on the diffusion-weighted imaging, you see that only the right-sided one are positive, signifying that they are at least acute or subacute. On the other side, on the left side, you see maybe a residual abnormality on the diffusion-weighted images, but not to the degree that you see on the contralateral side, implying that these infarcts occurred at different times. And on the diffusion-weighted image, if you pay attention on the top slot, on the top image here, you see that there is some thickening and enhancement of the supraclinal carotid artery, particularly on the left side, but also seen at the level of the right side. And farther on, at the level of the branches in the middle cerebral artery, you see a little bit of enhancement also in this branch here pointed by the arrow. Obviously, this infarct was subacute, so it's showing a little bit of contrast enhancement. Here are vessel wall imaging images of two different patients with varicella zoster 2, and what you see are this linear, almost plaque-like areas of enhancement in different parts of the middle cerebral artery. That's the most typical finding in vasculitis. So it is important because if you want to find a vessel that you want to biopsy, you obviously want to biopsy the site that is enhancement, not the site that is not enhancing of that blood vessel. Now, any of you guys that are familiar with vessel wall imaging, tell me, well, that's a weird vessel wall imaging because your CSF is not black as it should be in vessel wall imaging. It happens that in this case is that we have seen a varicella zoster vasculitis. Vessel wall imaging shows you that this diffuse enhancement of the subarachnoid space with enhancement of the CSF containing spaces in the vascular cisterns. I don't know what that is. Must be that the inflammation is a diffuse process in the brain. Okay, so we talk about varicella zoster in immunocompetent patients, but what happens if you're immunodeficient? And here's a patient with AIDS that was proven to have varicella zoster vasculitis, bilateral distal infarcts in the posterior aspect of the brain, and the MRA that you see basically looks normal. Your MRA at 1.5 or even 3 Tesla will not have the ability to resolve the abnormalities on the arteries that are distal to the secondary branches of the major arteries in the brain. So in this case, the MRA looks absolutely normal. It's a different case of a viral vasculitis, and this is herpes virus, and you can see that there is enhancement and thickening of the structures within Meckel's cave, the Caesarean ganglion. And if you look at the artery just beside it, there is diffuse enhancement of the vessel wall, but medially where it tends to abut the Caesarean ganglion, you have this nodular enhancement of the blood vessel wall and thickening too. And if you look at the supraclinal carotid artery, on this side it looks absolutely normal, but on this side you see vessel wall enhancement posteriorly extending into the posterior wall of the middle cerebral artery proximally. Okay, should be able to make the diagnosis too of the third case, young female with decreased pulses in both arms. On the neck and hands study, you see thickening of the common carotid artery on the right, then significant wall thickening of the common carotid artery on the left. You don't see the intraluminal flow void because that artery is occluded. Gadolinium enhanced MRA of the neck shows you the expected findings. There's no common carotid artery on that side. And if you look at the gadolinium enhanced MRA of the chest, you see the narrowing of the subclavian artery on this side and the occlusion of the subclavian artery on the opposite side. So based on those imaging findings in the clinical history, the diagnosis is what, guys? Takayasus, yes, correctly. So this serves as an introduction to the autoimmune vasculitis. And as you know, according to the Chapel Hill criteria, they are classified according to the size of the vessel involved. Large vessels, the most common ones are Takayasu and temporal arteritis, medium-sized vessels, polyarteritis nodosa, In small vessels, what we now call granulomatosis with polyangiitis that we used to call Wegener's, those are associated with this positive antibodies, the ANCA antibodies that stand for anti-neutrophil cytoplasmatic antibodies. And of course, there are things like Beckett's or Behçet's, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, that will affect any size arteries, and these are very, very rare. I think that we see a case of Behçet's maybe every 1 or 2 years. So coming back to Takayasu's arteritis, prototypical arteritis affecting large vessels, pretty rare, but much more common in Asia than in the Western world, particularly affecting youngish women. Affects the artery, the aorta and major arteries. There are two stages of the disease. The first stage, you have systemic symptoms and thickening and wall enhancement, but no occlusion. This is called the pre-pulseless stage or phase. And then you have the occlusive phase, in which you have all of the findings that I show you on the previous MRA. Mortality is about 30%. It is my understanding that most of the mortality is due to heart disease. So here we have a case in the pre-pulseless phase, a lot of dilatation, but no occlusions. And here we have an extreme case in the occlusive phase in which there's occlusion of the aorta and basically occlusion of all of the arteries arising from it, and all of the flow upstream is via collateral circulation. Okay, so case number 4. Some infarcts, gray and white matter on the diffusion-weighted imaging. Some abnormalities on the FLAIR image. Not all of them have infarcts. On the angiogram, can you see my pointer? No, I don't think that you can see my pointer at all. But you see multiple areas of narrowing of the vessels and dilatation of the vessels, typical findings of vasculitis. But what's key here is this reddish rash involving in a circumferential fashion the ankles and the feet. And that should help you make the diagnosis, which is what, guys? Polyarteritis nodosa. So this is the prototypical vasculitis affecting medium-sized vessels, rare in children. In order to make the diagnosis, you must demonstrate that there is a necrotizing vasculitis in the addition to the skin lesions that I show you, myalgia, hypertension, neuropathy, or involvement of the kidneys. What is said to be typical in histology are these microaneurysms that arise from the affected arteries. However, on imaging, we almost never see them. What we see by imaging is the typical findings of vasculitis. And the mortality is a little bit less than in other vasculitis, as it is my understanding that complete remission with immunomodulating therapy is possible. Here's another case showing you abnormality on the FLAIR image in the left occipital lobe, some punctate enhancement in the periventricular area, most likely along the perivascular spaces. Angiographic image in the middle of the slide showing you that typical dilatation and narrowing, kind of like a rat chew the wall of the blood vessel. And on the vessel wall imaging on the right hand of the slide, you can see significant thickening of the wall vessel there with yellow arrows and significant luminal narrowing too, implying an active inflammation of the blood vessel wall. Okay, I'm not going to tell you anything about this patient. You should be able to make a diagnosis just based on the imaging findings. I think that the T2-weighted image is fairly nonspecific, some periventricular white matter stuff in there. On the angiographic DSA image, you see the typical findings of a vasculitis. And once you've identified one artery that's affected on the DSA, you start looking around, and the more you look, the more you're going to see, the more arteries are going to find involved. But the key in this case is the midline image. Notice that there is an acquired hypoplasia of the maxillary sinuses, which has been replaced by kind of a fibrous osseous tissue there. This leads to the fact that the nasal cavity appears to be expanded, but what really this is due to is the hypoplasia of the maxillary sinuses. Now, the midline structures, turbinates, nasal septum have all disappeared secondary to erosion due to the vasculitis, and the diagnosis is what? So Wegener's granulomatosis, or what we now call granulomatosis with polyangiitis. In 2006, the guys from the Mayo Clinic published an article saying that there was evidence that Wegener had been involved in the Nazi experiments. So his name was taken off the name of the vasculitis, and there was a lot of infighting to see what kind of name was going to be given. But in 2011, I think it was the American Academy of Rheumatology that suggested the name of granulomatosis with polyangiitis. So this is the prototypical small vessel artery vasculitis. It tends to occur also in a younger person. Only 5% of patients will have involvement of the brain. And because these ANCAs are produced by B lymphocytes, these drugs based on monoclonal antibodies have a very good effect or beneficial effect on them. Brain findings, infarcts, these patchy areas of white matter disease in the periventricular white matter, which simulate demyelination lesions and inflammatory hypophysitis, pachymeningitis, and you must fulfill three of the Chapel Hill criteria to make the diagnosis, and those are a positive histology, kidney involvement, sinonasal involvement, like I show you, involvement of the larynx or the trachea, pulmonary, and a positive ANCAS. Okay, so this is the typical patient postpartum, several days postpartum, comes in with a headache. It's imaged for venous thrombosis. There's no venous thrombosis, but what we find is this area of increased signal intensity in the splenium of the corpus callosum, and when you look at the MRA, there is this florid appearance of a vasculitis involving all the secondary and tertiary blood vessels. You see it bilaterally involving the MCA and its branches. You see the posterior cerebral arteries involved bilaterally. And when you look at the DSA on the right hand of the slide, if you look, there's an artery there in the middle of the slide. I'm sorry, this pointer is not working, but there's an artery there that has this very, very significant looking of vasculitis. This is one of the conditions in which this look of vasculitis-like look is very, very striking. But I think that the imaging findings and the history ought to suggest the diagnosis to you guys. And what is the diagnosis? Yeah, reversal of vasoconstriction syndrome. And until a few years ago, we used to call this postpartum angiopathy. It tends to happen about 2 weeks after giving birth, generally about 5 days. Symptoms tend to be fairly nonspecific, and the only thing that has been found to be a predisposing factor is the administration of ergo-like medications for the control of postpartum bleeding or for the prevention of postpartum bleeding. This has been found to have been given in about 30% of patients that develop these findings. Literature states that MRI, just simple anatomic MRI, is normal in about two-thirds of patients, but other lesions which may simulate press or infarcts or bleeds may be present in about 30% of patients. And something that's not mentioned there is this typical lesion involving the splenium of the corpus callosum with restricted diffusion. Now, if you look at DSA, digital subtraction angiography, it's going to be abnormal in all of these patients. Well, if you look at vessel wall imaging, initially it was thought that vessel wall imaging could be used to distinguish this from a true vasculitis because vessel wall imaging was going to be negative in all of these patients. However, there have been recent reports of positive vessel wall imaging, and we don't know why vessel wall imaging is positive in this case when there is no active inflammation of the blood vessel wall. So I'm including this here as a differential diagnosis of vasculitis because by imaging, be it anatomical imaging or DSA or vessel wall imaging, it may simulate a vasculitis. And obviously, you want to consider this in the right clinical history as you don't want to put these patients in any kind of immunomodulating drug, and particularly you don't want these patients to undergo a brain biopsy. Outcome, not great. It's good in about 50% of patients, and death occurs in about 20% of these patients, and you can see the type of treatment that is needed for these patients. Here is from the literature. I had not had the personal experience of doing vessel wall imaging in any patient that shows findings compatible with the reversal of vasoconstriction syndrome, but you can see the angiographic images on the bottom showing you this irregular arteries, and on the top of the slide, you can see they're pointed with a white arrow, this segmental wall enhancement. But again, this is not vasculitis. This is some wall enhancement that nobody knows what it is due to. Now let's talk a few minutes about vessel wall imaging. So what is vessel wall imaging? Vessel wall imaging is a very high resolution technique, generally a 3D acquisition, better done at 3 Tesla. You need to get isotropic voxels because you need to be able to reconstruct it in several planes without losing any of your resolution. And the goal of vessel wall imaging is to have a postgadolinium image in which the CSF is going to be dark and the intraluminal flowing blood is going to be dark. If you do, like we do, postgadolinium T1MP rages, your images are going to look like the one on the left hand of the slide where you see that the flowing blood with gadolinium looks very bright. So now imagine if you had vessel wall enhancement, you really wouldn't be able to tell or separate the vessel wall enhancements from this intraluminal contrast enhancement. So you need to do an image like the ones that's in the middle or the right hand of the slide, in which, despite the fact that gadolinium was given to the patients, you see that the flowing blood is still black and that the CSF is kind of grayish. On the one in the middle, it was obtained on our 1.5s, So it's more or less like a proton density image. The one on the right hand was obtained on the 3 Tesla, so it's more like a black blood imaging with black surrounding CSF. Even the resolution looks a little bit better on the 3 Tesla than it does on the 1.5, and the time of acquisition, independent of the magnet, tends to be very long, 5 to 7 minutes, so you need your patients to cooperate. So that is what vessel wall imaging is. It's a high-resolution technique that attempts to turn your flowing, contrast-enhanced blood black in the surrounding CSF spaces black so you can see any degree of wall enhancement. Now, if I don't have vessel wall imaging, what if I just do conventional anatomic MR and diffusion-weighted imaging? Well, conventional anatomic MR plus diffusion-weighted imaging is going to be positive in the great majority of patients, as is seen from this article that I think came from the Mayo Clinic and was published a long time ago in 1999 in AJNR. The problem with this is that there's very little agreement between what you see on the MRI and the DSA, meaning that the regions that are affected on the MRI are not going to be the same regions that are going to be affected on the digital subtraction angio. And in a more recent article published in the clinical literature, you see also that there was very little agreement between what they saw on MRI and what they saw on histology. So again, the diagnosis tends to be very, very difficult. Now, how about perfusion-weighted imaging? Well, we don't do perfusion imaging in patients with vasculitis. I don't think that there's much utility in it. In this case, published in the literature, you see an area of increased signal intensity on the flare images on the right posterior temporal. There's some gadolinium enhancement, and there's no restriction of diffusion. So they went ahead and did perfusion because they thought probably this was some kind of neoplasia. The perfusion shows a defect on the cerebral blood volume map, as expected from a subacute infarct, that this was proven to be secondary to a vasculitis. But, you know, we don't do perfusion as a primary method of diagnosing vasculitis, and we don't do perfusion as a, MR spectroscopy as a primary method also for diagnosing vasculitis. MR spectroscopy will show you only the presence of lactate and perhaps some decrease from the malfunctioning neurons, but we don't use those for the diagnosis of vasculitis. So just to finish the lecture, again, the diagnosis is extremely difficult. These are obviously two cases of vasculitis. The one on the left, you see this white matter disease extending superficially to the deeper aspects of the brain. It's predominantly frontal, but it's extending into the posterior aspects of the brain. What would be your differential diagnosis if you saw this in the reading room? If it was a younger child or a younger person, we would probably say Alexander's disease or something weird like that. Maybe some toxic encephalopathy, some maybe radiation in it. We had no idea what it was. There's another case on the right hand of the slide. You have this cloud-like areas of signal intensity abnormality on the FLIR image in the periventricular white matter, sparing the superficial white matter. What would be your differential diagnosis again in this case? Probably something nonspecific, including all of the things that we mentioned for the other case. But both of these cases received different diagnoses. The first one was a granulomatous angiitis, and the second one was a lupus-related vasculitis. So to conclude again, diagnosis of vasculitis is very difficult. You must have a very high clinical suspicion. If the inflammatory markers are positive, that helps you suggest that it is a vasculitis. Obviously, predisposing factors like we saw in the previous case, a patient with lupus, that helps you suggest to the diagnosis. Anatomical imaging plus diffusion-weighted imaging is a good way to start. As we saw, it's going to be positive in the great majority of patients. Vessel wall imaging is perhaps the best thing that we have to diagnose because it allows us to see directly the inflammatory process involving the vessel wall. But remember that there are other things, like I show you the case on reversal vasoconstriction syndrome, that will also have vessel wall enhancement. MRA, only useful for larger vessels, even at 3 Tesla. You probably will need DSA, but remember DSA is just a luminal study. It's not showing you the active inflammation, but it's showing you the luminal changes on the vasculitis. And most patients will need a biopsy for diagnosis because the treatment is so aggressive that the treatment will not be given to these patients unless a diagnosis has been established. So with that, I want to finish the lecture and thank you very much. And I want to invite our next lecturer, who is Richard.